Disc 34, Thud. By Terry Pratchett. Audiobook 1x21. Thud. The first thing Tack did, he wrote himself. The second thing Tack did, he wrote the laws. The third thing Tack did, he wrote the world. The fourth thing Tack did, he wrote a cave. The fifth thing Tack did, he wrote a geode, an egg of stone. And in the twilight of the mouth of the cave, the geode hatched and the brothers were born. The first brother walked towards the light, and stood under the open sky. Thus he became too tall. He was the first man. He found no laws, and he was enlightened. The second brother walked towards the darkness, and stood under a roof of stone. Thus he achieved the correct height. He was the first dwarf. He found the laws Tack had written, and he was endarkened. But some of the living spirit of Tack was trapped in the broken stone egg, and it became the first troll, wandering the world unbidden and unwanted, without soul or purpose, learning or understanding. Fearful of light and darkness, it shambles forever in twilight, knowing nothing, learning nothing, creating nothing, being nothing. From G.D. Tackgar, The Things Tack Wrote, Trans. Prof. W. Wild Blood, Unseen University Press, AM $8. In the original, the last paragraph of the quoted text appears to have been added by a much later hand. Him who mountain crush him, know him who sun him stop him, know him who hammer him break him, know him who fire him fear him, know him who raise him head above him heart him diamond. Translation of troll pictograms found carved on a basalt slab in the deepest level of the Ankh-Morpork treacle mines, in pig treacle measures estimated at 500,000 years old. Thud. That was the sound the heavy club made as it connected with the head. The body jerked, and slumped back. And it was done, unheard, unseen. The perfect end, a perfect solution, a perfect story. But, as the dwarfs say, where there is trouble you will always find a troll. The troll saw. It started out as a perfect day. It would soon enough be an imperfect one, he knew, but just for these few minutes it was possible to pretend that it wouldn't. Sam Vimes shaved himself. It was his daily act of defiance, a confirmation that he was, well, plain Sam Vimes. Admittedly, he shaved himself in a mansion, and while he did so his butler read out bits from the Times, but they were just circumstances. It was still Sam Vimes looking back at him from the mirror. The day he saw the Duke of Ankh there would be a bad day. Duke was just a job description, that's all. Most of the news is about the current dwarfish situation, sir, said Willikins as Vimes negotiated the tricky area under the nose. He still used his granddad's cutthroat razor. It was another anchor to reality. Besides, the steel was a lot better than the steel you got today. Sybil, who had a strange enthusiasm for modern gadgetry, kept on suggesting he get one of those new shavers, with a little magic imp inside that had its own scissors and did all the cutting very quickly, but Vimes had held out. If anyone was going to be using a blade near his face, it was going to be him. Come Valley, he muttered to his reflection. Anything new? Not as such, sir, said Willikins, turning back to the front page. There is a report of that speech by Gragham Crusher. There was a disturbance afterwards, it says. Several dwarfs and trolls were wounded. Community leaders have appealed for calm. Vimes shook some lather off the blade. Ha! I bet they have. Tell me, Willikins, did you fight much when you were a kid? Were you in a gang or anything? I was privileged to belong to the Shamlegger Street Rude Boys, sir, said the butler. Really? Said Vimes, genuinely impressed. They were pretty tough nuts, as I recall. Thank you, sir, said Willikin smoothly. I pride myself I used to give thank you, sir, said Willikin smoothly. I pride myself I used to give somewhat more than I got if we needed to discuss the vexed area of turf issues with the young men from Rope Street. Stevedore's hooks were their weapon of choice, as I recall, and yours, said Vims, agog. A cap brim sewn with sharpened pennies, sir. An ever-present help in times of trouble. Ye gods, man. You could put someone's eye out with something like that with care, sir, yes, said Willikins, meticulously folding a towel. And here you stand now, in your pinstripe trousers and butlering coat, shiny as schmaltz and fat as butter, Vims thought, while he tidied up under the ears. And I'm a duke. How the world turns. And have you ever heard someone say let's have a disturbance, he said. Never, sir, said Willikins, picking up the paper again. Me neither. It only happens in newspapers. Vims glanced at the bandage on his arm. It had been quite disturbing, even so. Did it mention I took personal charge, he said. No, sir. But it does say here that rival factions in the street outside were kept apart by the valiant efforts of the watch. Sir, they actually used the word valiant, said Vims. Indeed they did, sir. Well, good, Vims conceded grumpily. Do they record that two officers had to be taken to the free hospital, one of them quite badly hurt, unaccountably not, sir, said the butler. Hey. Typical. Oh, well. Carry on. Willikins coughed a butlery cough. You might wish to lower the razor for the next one, sir. I got into trouble with her ladyship about last week's little Nick. Vims watched his image sigh, and lowered the razor. All right, Willikins. Tell me the worst. Behind him, the paper was professionally rustled. The headline on page 3 is Vampire Officer for the Watch, said the butler, and took a careful step backwards. Damn. Who told them? I really couldn't say, sir. It says you are not in favor of vampires in the watch but will be interviewing a recruit today. It says there is a lively controversy over the issue. Turn to page 8, will you? Said Vims. Behind him, the paper rustled again. Well, he said. That's where they usually put their silly political cartoon, isn't it? It, you did put the razor down, did you, sir? Said Willikins. Yes, perhaps it would also be just as well if you stepped away from the wash basin, too, sir. There's one of me, isn't there? Said Vims grimly. Indeed there is, sir. It portrays a small nervous vampire and, if I may say so, a rather larger-than-life drawing of yourself leaning over your desk, holding a wooden stake in your right hand. The caption is, any good on a stakeout, eh? Sir, this being a humorous wordplay referring, on the one hand, to the standard police procedure, yes, I think I can just about spot it, said Vims wearily. Any chance you could nip down and buy the original before Sybil does? Every time they run a cartoon of me, she gets hold of it and hangs it up in the library. Mr. Fizz does capture a very good likeness, sir, the butler conceded. And I regret to say that her ladyship has already instructed me to go down to the Times office on her behalf. Vims groaned. Moreover, sir, Willikins went on, her ladyship desired me to remind you that she and young Sam will meet you at the studio of Sir Joshua at 11 sharp, sir. The painting is at an important stage, I gather, but she was very specific, sir. She said if a commander of police cannot take time off, who can? On this day in 1802, the painter Methodia Rascal woke up in the night because the sounds of warfare were coming from a drawer in his bedside table. Again. One little light illuminated the cellar, which is to say that it lent different textures to the darkness and divided shadow from darker shadow. The figures barely showed up at all. It was quite impossible, with normal eyes, to tell who was talking. This is not to be talked about, do you understand? Not talked about? He's dead, this is dwarf business. It's not to come to the ears of the city watch. They have no place here. Do any of us want them down here? They do have dwarf officers, ha. Dear Kaza. Too much time in the sun. They're just short humans now. Do they, ha? Dear Kaza. Too much time in the sun. They're just short humans now. Do they think dwarf? And Vims will dig and dig and wave the silly rags and tatters they call laws. Why should we allow such a violation? Besides, this is hardly a mystery. Only a troll could have done it, agreed? I said. Are we agreed? That is what happened, said a figure. The voice was thin and old and, in truth, uncertain. Indeed, it was a troll, said another voice, almost the twin of that one, but with a little more assurance. The subsequent pause was underlined by the ever-present sound of the pumps. It could only have been a troll, said the first voice. And is it not said that behind every crime you will find the troll? There was a small crowd outside the watchhouse in Pseudopolis Yard when Commander Sam Vims arrived at work. It had been a fine sunny morning up until then. Now it was still sunny, but nothing like as fine. The crowd had placards. Bloodsuckers out, Vims read, and no fangs. Faces turned towards him with a sullen, half-frightened defiance. He uttered a bad word under his breath, but only just. Otto Creek, the Times iconographer, was standing nearby, holding a sunshade and looking dejected. He caught Vims's eye and trudged over. What's in this for you, Otto? Said Vims. Come to get a picture of a jolly good riot, have you? It's news, Commander, said Otto, looking down at his very shiny shoes. Who tipped you off? I just doozer pictures, Commander, said Otto, looking up with a hurt expression. Anyway, I couldn't tell you even if I knew, because of zer freedom of zer press, freedom to pour oil on a flame, do you mean? Vims demanded. That's freedom for you, said Otto. No one said it was nice but. Well, you're a vampire, too, said Vims, waving a hand towards the protesters. Do you like what's been stirred up? It's still news, Commander, said Otto meekly. Vims glared at the crowd again. It was mostly human. There was one troll, although admittedly the troll had probably joined in on general principles, simply because something was happening. A vampire would need a masonry drill and a lot of patience before it could put a troll to any trouble. Still, there was one good thing, if you could call it that. This little sideshow took people's minds off Cum Valley. It's strange that they don't seem to mind you, Otto, he said, calming down a little. Yell, I'm not official, said Otto. I do not have zer sword and zer badge. I do not threaten. I am just a varking stiff. And I make them laugh. Vim stared at the man. He'd never thought about that before. But yes. Little fussy Otto, in his red-lined black opera cloak with pockets for all his gear, his shiny black shoes, his carefully cut widow's peak and, not least, his ridiculous accent that grew thicker or thinner depending on who he was talking to, did not look like a threat. He looked funny, a joke, a music hall vampire. It had never previously occurred to Vims that, just possibly, the joke was on other people. Make them laugh, and they're not afraid. He nodded to Otto and went inside, where Sergeant Cheery Little Bottom was standing. On a box. At the two high-duty officers' desk, her chevrons all shiny and new on her sleeve. Vims made a mental note to do something about the box. Some of the dwarf officers were getting sensitive about having to use it. I think we could do with a couple of lads standing outside, Cheery, he said. Nothing provocative, just a little reminder to people that we keep the peace. I don't think we'll need that, Mr. Vims, said the dwarf. I'm not interested in seeing a picture in the Times showing the watch's first vampire recruit being mobbed by protesters, Corps Sergeant, said Vims severely. I thought you wouldn't be, sir, said Cheery. So I asked Sergeant Angua to fetch her. They came in the back way half an hour ago. She's showing her the building. I think they're down in the locker room. You asked Angua to do it, said Vims, his heart sinking. Yes, sir, said Cheery, suddenly looking worried. Is there a problem? Vims stared at her. She's a good orderly officer, he thought. I wish I had two more like her. And she deserved the promotion, heavens no, but, he reminded himself, she's from Uberwald, isn't she? She should have remembered about the thing between them and werewolves. Maybe it's my fault. I tell em that all coppers are just coppers. What? Oh, no, he said. Probably not. A vampire and a werewolf in one room, he thought, as he headed on up the stairs to his office. Well, they'll just have to deal with it. And that'll be only the first of our problems. And I took Mr. Pessimil up to the interview room, Cheery called after him. Vim stopped mid-stair. Pessimil, he said. The government inspector, sir, said Cheery. The one you told me about. Oh yes, thought Vims. The second of our problems. Oh yes, thought Vims. The second of our problems. It was politics. Vims could never get a handle on politics, which was full of traps for honest men. This one had been sprung last week, in Lord Veterinary's office, at the normal daily meeting. Ah, Vims, said his lordship as Vims entered. So kind of you to come. Isn't it a beautiful day? Up until now, Vims thought, when he spotted the two other people in the room. You wanted me, sir, he said, turning to Veterinary again. There's a Silicon Anti-Defamation League march in Water Street and I've got traffic backed up all the way to Leastgate. I'm sure it can wait, Commander. Yes, sir. That's the trouble, sir. That's what it's doing. Veterinary waved a languid hand. But full carts congesting the street, Vims, is a sign of progress, he declared. Only in the figurative sense, sir, said Vims. Well, at any rate I'm sure your men can deal with it, said Veterinary, nodding to an empty chair. You have so many of them now. Such an expense. Do sit down, Commander. Do you know Mr. John Smith? The other man at the table took the pipe out of his mouth and gave Vims a smile of manic friendliness. I don't believe WWWE have had the pleasure, he said, extending a hand. It should not be possible to roll your W's, but John Smith managed it. Shake hands with a vampire? Not bloody likely, Vims thought. Not even one wearing a badly hand-knit pullover. He saluted instead. Pleased to meet you, sir, he said crisply, standing to attention. It really was an awful garment, that pullover. It had a queasy zigzag pattern, in many strange, unhappy colors. It looked like something knitted as a present by a color-blind aunt. The sort of thing you wouldn't dare throw away in case the rubbish collectors laughed at you and kicked your bins over. Vims, Mr. Smith is Veterinary began. President of the Ankh-Morpork Mission of the Überwald League of Temperance, said Vims. And I believe the lady next to him to be Mrs. Doreen Winkings, treasurer of SAME. This is about having a vampire in the watch, isn't it, sir? Again. Yes, Vims, it is, said Veterinary. And, yes, it is again. Shall we all be seated? Vims. Vims. There was no escape, Vims knew, as he sagged resentfully into a chair. And this time he was going to lose. Veterinary had cornered him. Vims knew all the arguments for having different species in the watch. They were good arguments. Some of the arguments against them were bad arguments. There were trolls in the watch, plenty of dwarfs, one werewolf, three golems, an Igor and, not least, Corporal Knobs, one so why not a vampire? And the League of Temperance was a fact. Vampires wearing the League's black ribbon, not one drop, were a fact, too. Admittedly, vampires who had sworn off blood could be a bit weird, but they were intelligent and clever and as such a potential asset to society. And the watch was the most visible arm of government in the city. Why not set an example? Because, said Vims's battered but still functional soul, you hate bloody vampires. No messing about, no dissembling, no weasel words about the public won't stand for it or it's not the right time. You hate bloody vampires and it's your bloody watch. The other three were staring at him. Mr. Vims, said Mrs. Winkings, we cannot help but notice that you still have not employed any of our members in the VATCH. Say watch, why don't you? Vims thought. I know you can. Let the 23rd letter of the alphabet enter your life. Ask Mr. Smith for some, he's got more than enough. Anyway, I have a new argument. It's copper-bottomed. Mrs. Winkings, he said aloud, no vampire has applied to join the watch. They're just not mentally suited to a copper's way of life. And it's Commander Vims, thank you. Mrs. Winking's little eyes gleamed with righteous malice. Oh, are you saying vampires are stupid, she said. No, Mrs. Winking's, I'm saying that they're intelligent. And there's your problem, right there. Why would a clever person want one? This was a bit of a slur on Nobby, Vims had to admit. Nobby was human, just like many other officers. It was just that he was the only one who had to carry a certificate to prove it. To risk getting their natch their head kicked in on a daily basis for $38 a month plus allowances? Vampires have got class, an education, a von in front of their name. There's 100 better things for them to be doing than walking the streets as a cop. What do you want me to do, force them to join the walking the streets as a cop? What do you want me to do, force them to join the force? Wouldn't they be offered officer rank, said John Smith. There was sweat on his face and his permanent smile was manic. Rumor had it he was finding the pledge very hard going. No. Everyone starts on the street, said Vims. That wasn't entirely true, but the question had offended him. And on the night watch, too. Good training. The best there is. A week of rainy nights with the mists coming up and the water trickling down your neck and odd noises in the shadows. Well, that's when we find out if we've got a real copper. He knew it as soon as he said it. He'd walked right into it. They must have found a candidate. Vale, that is good news, said Mrs. Winkings, leaning back. Vims wanted to shake her and shout. You're not a vampire, Doreen. You're married to one, yes, but he didn't become one until a time when it is beyond human imagining that he could possibly have wanted to bite you. All the real black ribboners try to act normal and unobtrusive. No flowing cloaks, no sucking, and definitely no ripping the underwired night dresses off young ladies. Everyone knows John not a vampire at all. Smith used to be Count Vargo St. Gruet von Vilenus. But now he smokes a pipe and wears those horrible sweaters, and he collects bananas and makes models of human organs out of matchsticks because he thinks hobbies make you more human. But you, Doreen? You were born in Cockbill Street. Your mum was a washerwoman. No one would ever rip your nightdress off, not without a crane. But you're so into this, right? It's a damn hobby. You try to look more like vampires than vampires do. Incidentally, those fake pointy teeth rattle when you talk. Vims, Vims was aware that people had been speaking. Mr. Smith has some good news, said Veterinary. Indeed, yes, said John Smith, beaming manically. WWWE have a recruit for you, Commander. A vampire who wants to be in the Watch. And, of course, Zer Nightville not present a problem, said Doreen triumphantly. Ver Zer Night, are you trying to tell me that I must Vims began. Veterinary cut in quickly. Oh, no, Commander. We all fully respect your autonomy as head of the Watch. Clearly, you must hire whomsoever you think fit. All I ask is that the candidate is interviewed, in a spirit of fairness. Yeah, right, thought Vims. And politics with Uberwald will become just that bit easier, won't it, if you can say you even have a black ribboner in the Watch? Easier, won't it, if you can say you even have a black ribboner in the Watch? And if I turn this man down, I'll have to explain why. And I just don't like vampires, okay, probably won't do. Of course, he said. Send him along. He is in fact she, said Lord Veterinary. He glanced down at his paperwork. Salacia Delorsista Ammonita Triggs Tatra Zeldana Malifi. He paused, turned over several pages, and said, I think we can skip some of these, but they end von Humpting. She is 51, but he added quickly, before Vims could seize on this revelation, that is no age at all for a vampire. Oh, and she'd prefer to be known simply as Sally. The locker room wasn't big enough. Nothing like big enough. Sergeant Angua tried not to inhale. A large hall, that was fine. The open air, even better. What she needed was room to breathe. More specifically, she needed room not to breathe vampire. Damn cheery. But she couldn't have refused, that would have looked bad. All she could do was grin and bear it and fight down a pressing desire to rip out the girl's throat with her teeth. She must know she's doing it, she thought. They must know that they exude this air of effortless ease, confident in any company, at home everywhere, making everyone else feel second class and awkward. Oh, my. Call me Sally, indeed. Sorry about this, she said aloud, trying to force the hairs on the back of her neck not to rise. It's a bit close in here. She coughed. Anyway, this is it. Don't worry, it always smells like this in here. And don't bother to lock your locker, all the keys are the same and anyway most of the doors spring open if you hit the frame in the right way. Don't keep valuables in it. This place is too full of coppers. And don't get too upset when someone puts holy water or a wooden stake in there. Is that likely to happen? Said Sally. Not likely, said Angua. Certain. For instance, I used to find dog collars and bone-shaped biscuits in mine. Didn't you complain? What? No. You don't complain, snapped Angua, wishing she could stop inhaling right now. Already she was sure her hair was a mess. But I thought the Watch was look, it's nothing to do with what you. What we are, okay, said Angua. If you were a dwarf it'd be a pair of platform soles or a stepladder or something, although that doesn't happen so much these days. Mostly they try it on everyone. Although that doesn't happen so much these days. Mostly they try it on everyone. It's a copper thing. And then they'll watch what you do, you see? No one cares if you're a troll or a gnome or a zombie or a vampire, much, she added to herself, but don't let them believe you're a whiner or a snitch. And actually the biscuits were pretty good, to tell you the truth. Have you met Igor yet? Many times, said Sally. Angua forced a smile. In Uberwald, you met Igors all the time. Especially if you were a vampire. The one here, though, she said. I don't think so. Ah. Good. Angua normally avoided Igor's laboratory, because the smells that emanated therefrom were either painfully chemical or horribly, suggestively organic, but now she'd snuff them up with relief. She headed for the door with slightly more speed than politeness required, and knocked. It creaked open. Any door opened by an Igor would creak. It was a neck. Hi, Igor, said Sally cheerfully. Gimme six. Angua left them chatting. Igors were naturally servile, vampires were naturally not. It was an ideal match. At least she could go and get some air now. The door opened. Mr. Pessimal, sir, said Cheery, ushering a man not much taller than she was into Vimes's office. And here's the office copy of the Times. Mr. Pessimal was neat. In fact, he went beyond neat. He was a folding kind of person. His suit was cheap but very clean, his little boots sparkled. His hair gleamed, too, even more than the boots. It had a center parting and had been plastered down so severely that it looked as though it had been painted on his head. All the city's departments got inspected from time to time, veterinary had said. There was no reason why the watch should be passed over, was there? It was, after all, a major drain on the city coffers. Vimes had pointed out that a drain was where things went to waste. Nevertheless, veterinary had said. Just nevertheless. You couldn't argue with nevertheless. And the outcome was Mr. Pessimal, walking towards Vimes. He twinkled as he walked. Vimes couldn't think of another way to describe it. Every move was. Well, neat. Shovel purse and spectacles on a ribbon, I'll bet, he thought. Mr. Pessimal folded himself onto the chair in front of Vimes's desk and opened the clasps of his briefcase with two little snaps of doom. With some ceremony he the clasps of his briefcase with two little snaps of doom. With some ceremony he donned a pair of spectacles. They were on a black ribbon. My letter of accreditation from Lord Veterinary, Your Grace, he said, handing over a sheet of paper. Thank you, Mr. A. E. Pessimal, said Vimes, glancing at it and putting it on one side. And how can we help you? It's Commander Vimes when I'm at work, by the way I will need an office, Your Grace. And an oversight of all your paperwork. As you know, I am tasked to give His Lordship a complete overview and cost/benefit analysis of the watch, with any suggestions for improvement in every aspect of its activities. Your cooperation is appreciated but not essential. Suggestions for improvement, eh? Said Vimes cheerfully, while behind A. E. Pessimal's chair Sergeant Littlebottom shut her eyes in dread. Jolly good. I've always been known for my cooperative attitude. I did mention about the Duke thing, did I? Yes, Your Grace, said A. E. Pessimal primly. Nevertheless, you are the Duke of Ankh and it would be inappropriate to address you in any other way. I would feel disrespectful, I see. And how should I address you, Mr. Pessimal, said Vimes. Out of the corner of his eye he saw a floorboard on the other side of the room lift almost imperceptibly. A. E. Pessimal will be quite acceptable, Your Grace, said the inspector. The A standing for. Vims said, taking his eyes off the board for a moment. Just A, Your Grace, said A. E. Pessimal patiently. A. E. Pessimal, you mean you weren't named, you were annealed, just so, Your Grace, said the little man. What do your friends call you? A. E. Pessimal looked as though there was one major assumption in that sentence that he did not understand, so Vims took a small amount of pity on him. Well, Sergeant Littlebottom here will look after you, he said with fake joviality. Find Mr. A. E. Pessimal an office somewhere, Sergeant, and let him see any paperwork he requires. As much as possible, Vims thought. Bury him in the stuff, if it keeps him away from me. Thank you, Your Grace, said A. E. Pessimal. I shall need to interview some officers, too, why, said Vims. To ensure that my report is comprehensive, Your Grace, said Mr. A. E. Pessimal calmly. I can tell you anything you need to know, said Vims. I can tell you anything you need to know, said Vims. Yes, Your Grace, but that is not how an inquiry works. I must act completely independently. Quis custodiat ipsos custodes? Your Grace, I know that one, said Vims. Who watches the watchman?
Me, Mr. Pessimal.
Ah, but who watches you, Your Grace, said the inspector, with a brief smile. I do that, too. All the time, said Vims. Believe me, quite so, Your Grace. Nevertheless, I must represent the public interest here. I shall try not to be obtrusive. Very good of you, Mr. Pessimal, said Vims, giving up. He hadn't realized he'd been upsetting veterinary so much lately. This felt like one of his games. All right. Enjoy your hopefully brief stay with us. Do excuse me, this is a busy morning, what with the damn Cum Valley thing and everything. Come in, Fred. That was a trick he'd learned from veterinary. It was hard for a visitor to hang on when their replacement was in the room. Besides, Fred sweated a lot in this hot weather, he was a champion sweater. And in all these years he'd never worked out that when you stood outside the office door, the long floorboard seesawed slightly on the joist and rose just where Vims could notice it. The piece of floorboard settled again, and the door opened. Don't know how you do it, Mr. Vims, said Sergeant Colin cheerfully. I was just about to knock. After you'd had a decent earful, thought Vims. He was pleased to see A. E. Pessimal's nose wrinkle, though. What's up, Fred? He said. Oh, don't worry, Mr. Pessimal was just leaving. Carry on, Sergeant Littlebottom. Good morning, Mr. Pessimal. Fred Colin removed his helmet as soon as the inspector had been ushered away by Cheery, and wiped his forehead. It's heating up out there again, he said. We're in for thunderstorms, I reckon. Yes, Fred. And you wanted what, exactly, said Vims, contriving to indicate that while Fred was always welcome, just now was not the best of times. Er. Something big's going down on the street, sir, said Fred earnestly, in the manner of one who had memorized the phrase. Vims sighed. Fred, do you mean something's happening?
Yes, sir.
It's the dwarfs, sir. I mean the lads here. It's got worse. They keep going into huddles. Everywhere you look, sir, there's huddling going on. Only they stops as soon as anyone else comes close.
Even the sergeants. They stops and gives you a look, sir. And that's making the trolls edgy, as you might expect. We're not going to have Cum Valley replayed in this nick, Fred, said Vims. I know the city's full of it right now, what with the anniversary coming up, but I know the city's full of it right now, what with the anniversary coming up, but I'll drop like a ton of rectangular building things on any copper who tries a bit of historical recreation in the locker room. He'll be out on his arse before he knows it. Make sure everyone understands that. Yes, sir. But I ain't talking about all that stuff, sir. We all know about that, said Fred Cullen. This is something different, fresh today. It feels bad, sir, makes my neck tingle. Audiobook generated by Read with the Ears.